Dr. Rishi Mani Srivastava is going to talk on dysphagia, which is a very, very important topic of ENT. And we come across a lot of patients, but unfortunately, the knowledge about dysphagia and its management is lacking in our specialty. And I think it's going to be a very great topic to talk on and learn the facts about all the management and dysphagia. So I think we'll invite Dr. Rishi Mani from, I need to know exactly where he's working, sorry.
Good evening, sir. I'm Dr. Rishi Srivastava. I am ex from, my MBBS is from FMC Pune. And my PG is from PGI Chandigarh.
Our alumni, yeah? Great.
Yes, sir. 2008-2011 batch.
Okay, great.
I welcome all my seniors, especially my moderator, Dr. Raman Amrol, sir, and our super moderator, Dr. Prahlad, sir.
Moderator in chief.
Okay.
Should I start, sir?
Yeah, you should start. Yeah. Meanwhile, friends, all the participants, if you have any query, please post it on chat area so that the moderator can note those questions and at the end of the session, we can discuss. Yeah, any questions, please post on the chat area. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you can start.
Yeah. Yes, thank you. So I will be talking about dysphagia, its causes and management. Why it is not?
You go to the left side, lower this thing, there are directions, na?
Okay, okay, okay.
Yeah, and there you click it.
Yes, sir.
Next slide. Yeah, yeah.
Dysphagia is a difficulty in swallowing. Means either the patient is not able to swallow solids, liquids, or he's taking more time and effort to move solids or liquids from his mouth to his stomach. Deglutition is a complex coordinated process. It involves mucosal muscular system of upper aerodigestive tract requiring precise neuromuscular coordination. Basically, the swallowing or deglutition has three phases, oral, pharyngeal, and esophageal. Oral is oral preparatory, then oral transport phase. Coming to the pathophysiology, there may be derangement of a single or multiple factors. Maybe due to neurological disorder, any muscular disorder, neuromuscular coordination, mucosal disease, skeletal abnormality, or any deranged sensation which may lead to dysphagia. Others may be GRD, motility disorder, any infections causing dysphagia like candida or any herpes infection, whatever. So, as I was telling that three parts of transport is there, oral transport, pharyngeal transport. Oral phase dysphagia is there. Then food remains in the oral cavity. It may be due to decreased tongue movement or decreased soft palate movement. Then coming to the oropharyngeal dysphagia. In this, there may be decreased tongue-based movement. In that case, the food will remain in vallicula or on the upper part of the pharynx. If there is decreased constrictor muscles function, then food will stick all over pharynx and later aspiration will occur. If there is decreased tonsillar or fossil sensation, the area of tonsillar area decreased sensation is there, it may be either stroke or post-carcinoma resection, then the pharyngeal swallowing phase will be delayed. And if the pharyngeal reflex is delayed, then food will go to pharynx when larynx is still open and then aspiration will occur. The most important thing which is combined with dysphagia or which is often associated with dysphagia is aspiration. Aspiration may be pre-deglutitive type in which food will be in pharynx before pharyngeal reflex has started. It may be intradeglutitive. It may be seen in vocal cord palsy or decreased sensation of larynx, incomplete laryngeal closure or decreased laryngeal elevation. In post-deglutitive, there is decreased upper esophageal sphincter opening. It may be due to decreased laryngeal elevation post-stroke or post-RTE fibrosis, or decreased pharyngeal peristalsis, which may be due to stroke or post-pharyngeal fibrosis post-RTE. A very important component of dysphagia is upper esophageal sphincter. It should open very precisely so that the food goes from the pharynx to the esophagus. The upper esophageal sphincter opening, the most important component, is hyolaryngeal elevation. In the whole dysphagia, the main component which is supportive in swallowing is hyolaryngeal elevation. It is most important. Second is posterior retraction of the tongue. It creates the bolus pressure and which causes upper esophageal sphincter opening. Then the tone of upper esophageal sphincter should decrease. The pharyngeal peristalsis has minimal role. It is mainly for the clearing of food from the pharynx, not in the opening of upper esophageal sphincter. There are some cases in which increased tone of upper esophageal sphincter is there, like in Wallenberg syndrome, in Parkinsonism. There may be some causes of decreased tone of upper esophageal sphincter, like in myasthenia gravis or muscular dystrophy. Coming to the drugs causing dysphagia, I have not started the dysphagia proper, how we are taking the history, all the things. I am just focusing on the, in general, how, what are the components of dysphagia, what are the things which may cause dysphagia. Like if the patient is on sedatives, it decreases cortical and brainstem control and it may be important cause of dysphagia. Some drugs like aminoglycoside are NM junction blocker, neuromuscular junction blocker, and it may be causing dysphagia. Drug-induced myopathy can be done by steroids, fibrates, statins, gedobidines, cyclosporins. Anticholinergics have anti-muscarinic effects also, like amitriptyline, and it may be causing dysphagia. Esophagitis can occur due to tetracycline, potassium iodide, NSAIDs, quinines, bisphosphonate, which may be causing esophagitis and causing dysphagia. Xerostomia can be caused by antihistamines, anticholinergics, SSRI, ACE inhibitors, which may cause dysphagia. Movement disorders may occur in neurolepts and antipsychotics. Specifically, they affect the facial muscle movement and may cause dysphagia. Radiotherapy. Dysphagia occurs in post-radiotherapy patient, maybe due to xerostomia, mucositis, trismus, edema. Post-radiotherapy patient causes altered sensation and causing dysphagia in different ways. Subcutaneous induration can occur and it decreases hyolaryngeal excursion and decreases upper esophageal opening. RT-induced cranial nerve palsy sometimes occur by fibrosis or reduced vascular supply. And most commonly, it affects 12th nerve. Other cranial nerves it may be affected is 10th, recurrent anterior nerve, 11th nerve. All these causes either aspiration or dysphagia. If we combine radiotherapy with chemotherapy, then severity is increased. And dysphagia chances are more than 45% of patient. Aspiration in up to 30-35% of patient. In general, the time taken in different phases of swallowing, the oral phase, the time taken is not clearly defined, but still for small boluses, it should be less than 10 seconds. And from the pharyngeal phase, it should be less than 1 second. The velocity in pharyngeal phase is up to 40 centimeters per second. In esophageal phases, normally it takes 5 to 6 seconds to pass from the upper esophageal sphincter to GI junction. If it is taking more than 10 seconds, then it is abnormal. Coming to the now, the dysphagia evaluation proper. History, then clinical evaluation, then instrumental evaluation. Among the instrumental evaluation, the most important is VFS, FES, the video fluoroscopic study and fiber optic endoscopic evaluation of swallowing. Others sometimes like manometry can be done also for evaluation of dysphagia, and then the management is proceeded. Coming to the process of assessment, why we want to assess the patient? It is in
Yeah, Dr. Rishi, your voice is not audible.
Yes.
Yeah, can you repeat the slide?
Previous slide?
This slide, okay. Purpose of assessment, yeah.
Okay. Coming to the purpose of assessment, why we want to assess dysphagia? Most important purpose is dysphagia is often associated with aspiration. So swallowing safety is the most important thing. Nutritional assessment, whether patient is taking proper nutrition or not. In dysphagia patient, more than 30-35% patients are nutritionally deficient. And during assessment, diet modification may be managed. The patient is having which type of diet patient will be having so that he has less dysphagia. And most importantly, obviously, what is the cause of dysphagia? Coming to the history, we have to ask the chief complaint whether he has dysphagia, odynophagia, and other things. What patient is complaining of? Then if he complains that, yes, I am having dysphagia, difficulty in swallowing, whether he has difficulty in solids, liquids, or only pills. Dysphagia onset, duration, and progression. Associated voice change and weakness of voice. Any recent history of pneumonia or hospitalization? Any history of surgery, trauma, illness, medications? I have already explained. Addictions, I have already explained. Tobacco addiction or sometimes in alcohol addictions. Diabetes, the family history of specific diseases, especially diabetes, any muscular dystrophy diseases, systemic illness, pulmonary, cardiac, digestive, and why he was admitted in hospital, course of treatment in hospital, and history of intubation and tracheostomy. Prior to swelling assessment, we have to see the patient about his alertness, cognition, airway status, body posture, tone, and self-feeding potential. Because seeing this, we have to manage that patient, whether dysphagia, different exercises or different protocols or different maneuvers can be done in patient or not. Coming to the clinical examination, bedside examination, the malnutrition, whether patient is malnourished or not. Cranial nerve examination, basic, fifth nerve. It is important, the muscle, the trigeminal nerve gives supply to the muscles of mastication and the facial sensations. The seventh nerve, facial muscle weakness. If facial muscle weakness is there, then there will be pulling of boluses in the mouth itself, in the gingivobuccal sulcus, the test sensation. The ninth nerve, very important. We have to test by testing the gag reflex, tonsillar area sensation, and posterior one-third tongue test. The 10th nerve, testing by soft palate movement, pharyngeal movement, laryngeal movement. And the 12th nerve. In the 12th nerve palsy, tongue atrophy may be there, movement is decreased, and fibrillations may be there. Coming to the bedside screening. Indication. Bedside screening for dysphagia is done in patient not fit to transfer for definitive investigations. Like I have already explained about the fiber optic endoscopic evaluation of swallowing or video fluoroscopic studies. If patient is not fit for that examination, then we have to screen bedside. The screening of bedside has very good sensitivity, more than 90%, but specificity is approximately 66% only. In the bedside examination, first we have to see the dry swallow and see for laryngeal elevation. Laryngeal elevation is the most important part of the swelling thing. Larynx, if larynx is not being elevated, then cricopharynx won't open and the food won't go in the esophagus. Then food will go inside from the vocal cord and the patient will start aspirating. Then trial of swallow. Liquid, semi-solid, and solids. I'll be explaining. There are different protocols for clinical swallowing assessment, like Yale swallow protocols, and many protocols are there. Specifically, these protocols are done in the acute stroke patient. We use in this multiple consistencies of food. In bedside screening, the patient should perceive tester's face spoon texture in front of him to rule out any neglect and apraxia, because stroke patient, many patient of a stroke are suffering with apraxia or agnosia. In apraxia, patient don't know how to swallow. He keeps the food in his mouth. In agnosia, the patient don't know this stimulus, that this is food and it has to be swallowed. So we have to rule out these two things before starting the bedside swallowing screen. Primary assessment, I have already told that indirect swallowing test, vigilance, the patient vigilance, the voluntary cough, throat clearing, and saliva swelling. Before any screening, bedside screening, we have to make it certain that patient is not aspirating. His cough reflex are intact, he is able to clear his throat, and he is able to swallow his saliva. Then only we can start testing bedside. Indirect swallowing test, we perform sequentially. First the liquids, only the water, 3 ml, then we increase 5 ml, 10 ml, 20 ml, and lastly 50 ml. We ask the patient if he is swallowing the 5 ml, 10 ml, 20 ml without having any problem. Then we ask the patient to drink from glass or whatever fast up to 50 ml. If he passes this liquid test, then we ask him to swallow semi-solids. We can mix with artificial thickness, pudding consistency, we can put in water or whatever, and we have to ask him to swallow 1/3 to 1/2 teaspoon each time, and we have to sequentially increase. We can in solids use small pieces of dry breads and repeat 4 to 5 times. For this small solid, 10 seconds should be the time limit for the small solid bolus to be swallowed, including the oral preparatory phase. If it is more than 10 seconds, then there is definitely some problem. During this bedside screening test, we have to observe for any loss from mouth, any spontaneous coughing, spontaneous throat clearing, any gurgling sound, any wet voice, means the patient is aspirating, any nasal regurgitation, how much time he is taking for oral transit, and most importantly, laryngeal elevation. If larynx is not elevating, then patient is having severe dysphagia. We have to abort the investigation, means this bedside screening, if signs of aspirations are positive, like coughing, drooling, any voice change. And accordingly, the diet recommendations are given. Means if the patient is having coughing in liquids only, but not for semi-solids, then we have to thicken the food whenever we are going to give regularly starting his food. Pulse oximetry is inevitable too. All this bedside screening test, we have to put the pulse oximetry in the patient's finger and to see whether on swallowing, the patient saturation is decreasing. If it is decreasing to less than 92%, it means the patient is aspirating, because reflex, bronchospasm, hypoxia, desaturation occurs. This pulse oximetry is specifically important in silent aspiration. In silent aspiration, patient won't be coughing or choking, but bronchospasm will be there and hypoxia will be there. By that, we can know that the patient is silently aspirating, which is more, much, much more dangerous than normal aspiration. Then coming to the definitive diagnosis of swallowing, two important investigations are there. They are complementary to each other. Fiber optic endoscopic evaluation of swallowing. Second is video fluoroscopic swallowing study. This manometry is usually done when there is motility disorder, either upper esophageal sphincter dysfunction is there due to absent relaxation or due to any other cause, impaired bolus pressure or decreased hyalurongeal excursion. But the main two investigations are fiber optic endoscopic evaluation of swallowing and video fluoroscopic swallowing study. Coming to the fiber optic endoscopic evaluation of swallowing, it is for the anatomical and physiological evaluation of swallowing of pharyngeal phase, structural movement, and sensory status. And according to this study, we can manage the dietary, behavioral, and postural alteration during swallowing testing so that patient has less and less dysphagia. Its indication, it is mainly for oropharyngeal dysphagia and laryngeal dysphagia, but sometimes it can be also done for oral dysphagia. I will be explaining here. Then video fluoroscopy. The video fluoroscopy and endoscopic, the endoscopic advantages are better visualization of boluses by endoscope, obviously, the surface anatomy of the pharynx and the larynx, the mucosal surfaces, the velopharyngeal competence, laryngeal movements during swallowing, pharyngeal movements, the sensations. By sensations, we have to touch the iliopoglottic fold or arytenoid, and we have to see the laryngeal constriction by which we can know that whether the sensation is normal or not. Any retention and aspiration can be visualized directly. Video fluoroscopic swallowing study. Its advantages are it tests all phases from the oral cavity to the pharynx to the esophagus. We can clearly see the tongue posterior movement, the soft palate movement, and upper esophageal dysfunction, whether it is relaxing normally or in contracted state. We can also know the swelling response time. It should be less than 500 milliseconds. When the bolus is passing through the tonsillar fossil area, then the larynx should start elevating. This reflex time should be less than 0.5 seconds. If it is more than 0.5 seconds, then when the food will be going in the larynx will be opening and the patient will be aspirating. Pharyngeal transit time should be less than 1 second. On the fluoroscopy, we can see that how much time it is taking. If it is taking more than 1 second, then this is abnormal. The esophageal transit time, normally 5 to 6 seconds it takes. If it is taking more than 10 seconds, then it is abnormal. Sometimes septal obstruction can be seen on video fluoroscopic study, because on septal obstruction, endoscopy can miss. But the patient still has dysphagia, especially for solids or something, so for pills. On that, these cases, the video fluoroscopy will let you know that this part of the esophagus is having some constriction during swallowing. The video fluoroscopy can be combined with manometry, especially in motility disorder. Coming to the manometry, I have already explained to differentiate between the primary esophageal sphincter dysfunction or whether it is secondary. Sometimes in diffuse esophageal spasm, nutcracker esophagus manometry is very useful. Fiber optic endoscopic assessment of swelling. This can be done very easily, and I am regularly doing in my center, in my small clinic. In this, patient is made to sit upright or semi-reclinable position. Examiner is in front and flexural nasopharyngoscope is put inside the nose. Either fiber optic laryngoscope or transnasal esophagoscope can be put. No anesthesia is required. If a patient is a bit comfortable, local anesthesia can be used only in the form of jelly, no sprays. And while we are putting this inside the nose, two part of examination is there, one without food and one after giving food. When we are passing from the nose to the pharynx, then we watch for nasopharynx, any saliva is there. If saliva is there, then we may suspect that patient is having severe GERD. The velopharyngeal closure during phonation and the velopharyngeal closure during dry swelling. Any incompetence is there. Incompetence can occur in early Alzheimer's, Parkinsonism, or motor neuron disease. Any secretions popping up in the nasopharynx or in that area. Nasopharyngeal saliva, velopharyngeal closure, base of tongue movement, and hyopharynx and larynx at rest. Any secretions in larynx. Then we prepare food materials in different consistencies, in liquid, semi-solid and solid. In liquid, the plain water with some artificial coloring agent. In the semi-solid, we may use curd with artificial coloring agent. And the solid, a small biscuit or bread crumbs with artificial coloring agent. The sequence, usually we start from the liquid. Then we go for semi-solid, then solid. And we see the movements of velopharyngeal closure, again the tongue-based thrust and pharyngeal contraction, the laryngeal innervation, most importantly, the epiglottic inversion, retroversion, arytenoid movement, and laryngeal closure. And the most important, this white out. When the patient is swelling and your nasopharynx is in the pharynx, during swallow, the whole of the pharynx contracts. And for a second or a fraction of a second, you see nothing. This seeing nothing is very important. It means that pharyngeal squeeze is normal. If pharyngeal squeeze is abnormal, then no whiteout will be there. In that, we may look for spillage. The bolus in the oropharynx comes before the start of swelling. Means the patient is not able to hold the bolus in his oral cavity. Any residue means after swelling, if some residue is there still in the pharynx. If the residue is in vellucula, means either base of tongue propulsion defect is there or pharyngeal squeeze defect is there. And if the residue is in cricopharynx or piriform sinus, then it may be due to poor laryngopharyngeal elevation or cricopharyngeal opening defect, or there may be some growth in the cricopharynx or upper esophagus. We also see that on subsequent swallow, whether the bolus clears or not. Then we see the penetration and aspiration. Penetration means bolus is in laryngeal vestibule without crossing vocal cord, and aspiration when the bolus is beyond vocal cord. Silent aspiration. If the patient is aspirating but not coughing or choking, this means silent aspiration. It is very dangerous situation as the person will develop pneumonia sooner or later. Small video. Now on, these videos are of my clinic only. This is the patient. There is a lot of pooling of saliva in the piriform sinus above the cricopharynx. The patient is having penetration and aspiration. Actually, this patient was suffering from acute brainstem stroke. And the only problem came with this, the patient came walking only with his neck not able to swallow. Otherwise, no problem. He was absolutely normal. This was the picture which I saw and suspected that this patient is suffering from acute cricopharyngeal spasm. And I got that MRI brain done and there was brainstem stroke. I was telling that we are usually doing fiber optic endoscopic assessment of swelling. By this, we want to assess the pharyngeal swelling, which is very easy to do. But for oral also and esophageal assessment also we can use. For the oral swelling assessment, we can angulate our fiber optic laryngoscope and go inside the oral cavity to see what is happening in the oral cavity, whether the residue is present, where there is some pulling in the gingivobuccal sulcus and all those. And along with that, we can put it transnasal esophagoscope in the esophagus and ask the patient to swallow. And we may follow the bolus inside the esophagus to know what is happening inside the esophagus during swallowing. Complication. FIS is extremely safe procedure. Apart from a mild discomfort or epistaxis or sometimes some gagging, vomiting, nothing occurs. There is not even a single mortality reported by doing this fiber optic during this fiber optic endoscopic assessment. Laryngospasm never occurs. I have not seen, or I have not seen any paper which is saying that laryngospasm is occurring due to this procedure. This is the video done at my clinic, fiber optic endoscopic assessment. This was the patient. This I am going through the nasal cavity. Inside that, this is velopharyngeal closure. We are seeing during phonation and dry swallow. This is the base of tongue movement, the arytenoid, the vocal cord movement. Base of tongue movement is normal. Going inside, we had to touch this iliepiglottic fold to see the contraction of the larynx, whether it is occurring normally or not. Then we have to start giving the patient the normal boluses. This, the bolus gone. Now the bolus is gone. See how from the velluculite is gone. All right, it started. Oh, what is happening? This is another slide. This is the whiteout, what I was talking. For a fraction of a second, you will be seeing nothing. It means the pharyngeal mucus, the pharyngeal muscles have collapsed or constricted around your scope, and you are not able to see anything for a fraction of a second. This is very important. It means pharyngeal muscles are functioning. What you are seeing, that something is coming up, something is going down, larynx is going up and going down. It is important. It means laryngeal function are normal. On the posterior part, you may see in between the pharyngeal movements also during swallowing. This is the whiteout. Everything, pharynx is a very important part of the dysphagia. Everything you can see what is happening. And from the oral, from the oropharynx, you can go inside the oral cavity to see what is happening. Okay, coming to the next slide. This is some other patient of neurogenic dysphagia. Just want to show you something. See, the pulling of everything in the piriform sinus, cribriopharynx is not opening. And after a few seconds, it is going inside the vocal cord and patient is aspirating. Something is not going, not passing from this cribriopharyngeal area, piriform sinus. And later patient is aspirating. This was the typical case of brainstem stroke and having severe sudden cribriopharyngeal spasm. No other symptom was there. Many times in my clinic, I have suspected a stroke, and on MRI brain, it has came that stroke was there. Aspiration due to tracheostomy. We ENT surgeons, tracheostomy, we usually do a lot of tracheostomy, and tracheostomy increases the aspiration. It was the concept that tracheostomy is done to decrease the aspiration. No, tracheostomy increases aspiration due to mechanical cause, because it decreases laryngeal elevation, and due to neurophysiological causes, because it desensitizes the protective cuff reflex. The cuff reflex is decreased, and it decreases the laryngeal clearance also, because the normal air blast, which is coming from the lungs to the subglottis and to the upper part of the larynx, is lost. The cough is, so there is a lot of aspiration in stomach. And the Ryle's tube can cause aspiration because the residue is there in the peripheral sinus of the same side, and arytenoid edema is there. Coming to the management of dysphagia. See, swelling problems are mainly of three types: either misdirection of the bolus, or mistiming of the bolus, or ineffective swelling clearance. The two main types are there in the management: rehabilitative and compensatory. Rehabilitating means we want to restore the normal swallow function. But for this, patient has to do some exercises by himself. And for this, he requires good cognition. But benefits of these things are permanent. Then compensatory modification, compensatory techniques, in which we modify the diet, the posture, and sometimes some exercises also. This compensatory techniques are used during feast or video fluoroscopy study. It is primarily done by clinician, that you have to turn your head here and there and all those things. And for this, limited cognition requirement is there. Patient has immediate benefit. If he has paralysis on the right side and he is tilting the head towards left side and starts eating, then this aspiration and all the problems decreases immediately. But they are not the permanent benefits. Coming to the dietary modification, if one is aspirating on certain substance, you can change the diet, the texture. Like if the patient is having decreased tongue-based contraction after post-RT patient or reduced pharyngeal contraction, then you can ask him to take thin liquids, because by gravity itself, it will go down to the pharynx. If he has poor trunk control or reduced airway closure, then thick liquids will be there. Compensatory techniques are to control transport of bolus. Indirect therapy to improve neuromuscular function and control. It prepares the patient for safe introduction of food at later time when direct therapy can be started. Two therapies there, either direct or indirect. Direct means with diet. Indirect means without diet. Without diet, if you are asking him to do some maneuvers or some exercises, then this is indirect therapy. If with food you are asking him to do something this and something that, then this is known as direct therapy. If the patient is suffering with mistimed swelling, I have told that misdirected, mistimed, and decreased clearance. If mistimed swelling is there or delayed swelling there, then food is thickened so that more time is required to pass from the pharynx. So it can be managed better. The laryngeal closure in meanwhile is better. If early fatigue of muscles is there, specifically in motor neuron diseases, then we can blend the solid foods so that the patient has to exert less. For overall betterment of swelling, you have to give the food in moderate quantity. Very less quantity if you will be giving, then there will be less sensation by the food to his oral and pharyngeal mucosa, and there will be dysphagia. If large boluses are given, then chances of aspiration will increase. It should be moderately thick. And cold and sore food will increase sensitivity. You can use a cold spatula or cold spoon. You have to ask the attendants of the patient that before starting the food, or take out the any cold spatula or cold spoon from the fridge and touch the tonsillar area. It increases the sensitivity. You can put some lemon juices on his or some or other things which makes the food acidic or sour, and it increases the sensitivity. And as the sensitivity is increased, so the receptors works better and the patient dysphagia decreases. Coming to the different maneuvers, techniques, head flexion. Head flexion decreases laryngeal inlet. So it is very good when the vocal cord palsy is there or aspiration is there. when the bolus is going directly to the laryngeal inlet. But the problem is that it decreases the pharyngeal function. So when the pharyngeal paralysis is there, then you can't use this head flexion technique. Head extension can be used in tongue weakness and pharyngeal weakness, but the problem is that when you are using head extension, then pharyngeal muscle function is decreased and decreased duration of upper esophageal relaxation. So aspiration chances increases in head extension. The patient decompensate when you start him feeding in head extension. So you should give only when the tongue muscles are weak, like post resection patient, but pharyngeal weakness is not there. The larynx compatibility is good. Head turning. If you are turning the head towards right, then it blocks the piriform sinus of that side and foot don't enter on that side. So there are decreased chances of aspiration. Foot goes towards the better side. Head tilt, turn the head to the stronger side so that by gravity, foot goes from the stronger side and patient has less aspiration. If weakness of oromotor tongue or jaw muscles is there, we can start oromuscle exercises. The Sekkar's and Mendelssohn maneuver I'll be describing is used when hyolaryngeal movement is decreased. Thermal tactile stimulation, I have already told you. Some transcutaneous neuromuscular electric stimulation has come. I have not seen this. But it is said that it improves swallowing and it is better than thermal and tactile stimulation. Direct swallowing therapy means when we are doing with diet. Supraglottic swelling and super supraglottic swelling. Both is done in reduced airway closure, reduced laryngeal sensation and delayed pharyngeal swelling. I'll be explaining everything. When decreased hyolaryngeal elevation is there, then Sekkar exercise and Mendelssohn maneuver is there. And decreased laryngeal sensation is there. Supraglottic, I have already told you. In decreased pharyngeal function, effortful swallow is better. And in decreased pharyngeal movement and decreased tongue-based movement, then Masako maneuver. Ineffective bolus clearance is there, then do multiple effortful swallow. And you can modify bolus volume also. In misdirected swallow, due to incomplete valving, like vocal cord paralysis is there, then you can thicker the liquid and you can turn the head to the weaker side so that that piriform sinus is closed. These are the some pictures of range of movements. This I have given the overview of the swallowing. If you want me to continue or to take up some questions, because another the next topic is the neurology of swallowing. It is a big topic in itself. Then how we are going to diagnose the problems in a stroke patient related to swallowing, how to manage.
I think we have almost nearing 1 hour now. I think we'll take up questions for this session.
Yes, sir.
Since we have another webinar, I'm going to unmute to Dr. Raman. I think he has muted himself. Yeah, friends, if you have any questions, you can post on the chat. This thing.
I haven't seen any question on the chat box. Okay. So I don't know how to.
Yes, sir.
So you have to tell me, Rishi, as to on which of these patients will you decide that, okay, I need to subject this fellow for more tests.
Mm-hmm. So practically speaking, when the patient is coming with dysphagia, first we have to rule out, I ask the patient having severe GERD or the globus pharyngeal sensation. This globus pharyngeal sensation is very common and patient comes out that I have difficulty in swallowing, but he has globus sensation. When the food is going inside his esophagus or inside his throat in the patient words without having any obstruction, but he feels difficulty in swallowing his sputum only, then the patient may be suffering with globus pharyngeus due to whatever called GERD or motility disorder or whatever, cricopharyngeal spasm, whatever. When patient is saying that I'm not able to swallow for 2 days or whatever, 10 days, I'm not able to swallow even liquids or solids, then the first thing I put a 90-degree laryngoscope inside the mouth and to see the pharynx, whether he has got some palsy also. If paralysis is there, sudden vocal cord paralysis is there due to whatever, or bilateral paralysis, then due to aspiration also patient is not able to swallow. And he says only dysphagia is there. When severe GRD and vocal cord paralysis is not there, then I have to go for FEES, functional endoscopic, fiber optic endoscopic swelling study, to know that what is happening to the patient. If severe GRD, this globus sensation is not there, or the main problem is not globus pharyngeus, and the paralysis, any paralysis is not there, then I go for FEES study.
FEES study. Okay, perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, Raman. Hello. Yeah, there are other questions. Raman, are you there? Oh, he has muted himself.
Okay. Now I'm there.
Okay, yeah. There are many other questions now.
Yeah, so we have a lot of questions, in fact. So I'll ask Rishi three questions. And there are two questions combined. One is, what is the role of cricopharyngeal myomectomy and its utility? And how do you use the findings of FEES in guiding your myotomy? Rishi?
Yeah. Sir, practically, I have not done any cricopharyngeal myotomy. What the book says, that cricopharyngeal myotomy is done in primary cricopharyngeal dysfunction. When the cricopharynx is not able to relax itself. And before going for the myotomy or myomectomy cricopharynx, the best practice will be, we have to give some Botox injection in that. If the patient feels immediate relief after 1 or 2 weeks, that means the patient is suffering with primary cricopharyngeal primary cricopharyngeal problem, and myotomy or myomectomy will help. But if he has having secondary problems, like hyalangeal elevation is not there, post radiotherapy fibrosis is there, then in that case, this myotomy or myomectomy won't help. Even in fibrosis, whether if you have done in a fibrotic patient, then it will increase the reflux problem rather than benefiting.
Yeah, and is there any way that you can say that on the FEES that the patient may improve with myotomy?
No, sir. In the FEES, it is difficult to say. That patient will improve.
There is no guide. The FEES doesn't guide you.
When the FEES is combined with manometry examination, then you can know that whether it is due to increased tone or the tone is normal. If the increased tone is there, like in primary cricopharyngeal dysfunction, then myotomy or myomectomy will help. But if the tone is normal, then the problem is something else. The hyalangeal elevation is not there. Then myomectomy will worsen the situation. It will increase the reflex.
There is a question which says that how do you deal with patients with silent aspiration? Do you have an experience?
Yes, experience. But unfortunately, in five of the patient, two we have lost due to intractable pneumonia. In the silent aspiration, even tracheostomy doesn't help. It should be that laryngotracheal separation should be done ideally, in whatever ways, but patient, it is difficult to convince the patient attendants. We have lost three young patients because their attendants were not ready to do that. Because in silent aspiration, even the saliva, they are usually the post-stroke patient. Even saliva and oral cavity is infected, and they keep on having this pneumonia episode. And some pneumonia episode will cause such a great problem that patient dies. But it is very difficult to take a consent for this laryngotracheal separation in this patient.
Yeah, I remember during our rounds in PGI, our professor, if I remember correctly, Dr. Sharma used to tell us that the probably the severest or the cruelest indication of laryngectomy is the silent aspiration. And I don't think how many patients consented for that drastic treatment, but I think that's probably the only treatment.
Yeah. Even so, we are not doing laryngectomy, but we are after tracheostomy, we are stitching the trachea to the skin also.
It's okay. So there's one very important practical question actually. Patient having vocal cord palsy, any precautions for swallowing for this patient? Any position position that you advise to patient to swallow in this position to avoid aspiration and all that? Do you have any answer to that?
Yes, sir. Yes. So the vocal cord paralysis means recurrent laryngeal nerve is there. The upper esophageal sphincter also has supply from recurrent laryngeal nerve, superior laryngeal nerve, some part of recurrent and superior laryngeal nerve also. So along with this vocal cold palsy, there is some spasm of cricopharynx also. So the chances of aspiration increases.
Yeah.
In that, we have to ask the patient to turn the head towards the affected or paralyzed side and tilt the head towards the stronger side. By turning the head towards the affected side, the piriform sinus of that side is blocked. And on tilting towards the stronger side, now the food or liquid goes from the stronger side. So chances of aspiration is less. This all have to done with the feast guidance, whether even after this, the patient is aspirating or not. If not aspirating, it's good. Then the supraglottic swallowing and super supraglottic swallowing is for these type only. On just after swallowing, if the patient coughs, then whatever goes or going to the trachea will be coughed out. These all things is then feast guided. Whether after these procedures, patient is having aspiration or not, or how much aspiration is there, with which diet patient is having aspiration. It is not always it is not always easy to say that only with semi-solid the patient aspiration will less, or solid will be less, or liquids will be less. With which consistency patient is more comfortable, then we have to ask the patient to take more of that consistency food only.
One more question. It's a question for you. What is your management of a globus patient? It's a very common problem. And a lot of constitutes a lot of patients in the OPD. So what do you do for globus?
I'll be saying which is not written in the books, which is my experience only.
Yeah, that's important. Yes.
And I should publish a paper or whatever. It is not there in online.
Great.
Double dose of PPI. First is to rule out whatever is the cause, cricopharyngeal spasm or GRD, some large esophagus, some cervical vertebral problem or whatever. But in general, if no problem is detected other
which
than...
Which is the most common scenario. We don't see much of a finding in anything that you do.
Yes, sir.
So what do you
most
do?
Common is probably acidity associated.
Okay.
Double dose of PPI along with that amitriptyline, 5 to 10 milligram HS.
Okay.
Then haloperidol, Serenes, 0.25 milligram HS for 5 days, then 0.5 milligram HS for 1 or 2 months or whatever.
So, what is the use of haloperidol?
Sir, I have asked my secretary senior from PJ only. Actually, earlier I was using only pantoprazole and amitriptyline.
Yeah, triptomer 10 milligram is a common protocol we also follow in our OPD.
No, sir. But with this triptoma and this
Serenes,
only 34 to 40% people improve. But when you add this haloperidol, you yourself will see that up to 80% improvement is there.
Oh, really?
That's a great learning. Every day, if I see 60% in my OPD, at least 12 to 15% of this globus pharyngeus is there for months, for years.
Okay.
And I'm using मतलब इन ऑल द पेशेंट आई एम फ्रीली यूजिंग एंड दिस स्मॉल डोज ऑफ हैलोपेरिडॉल डजंट कॉजेस एनी प्रॉब्लम एनी
सो व्हाट इज द डोजेस कैन यू रिपीट दैट फॉर द लिसनर्स
आई स्टार्ट विद 0.25 मिलीग्राम ऑफ सेरेनेस
इन टू 5 डेज
5 डेज देन 2.5 आई नेवर यूज मोर देन 0.5
सो यू इंक्रीज द डोज आफ्टर 5 डेज
यस सर एंड इफ along with that patient doesn't improve after 3-4 weeks then sometimes I use clonazepam because clonazepam is a GABAergic drug it has inhibitory effect so means GABA has inhibitory effect and clonazepam
so you, that is 0.5 or 0.25
so 0.25
that is sometimes 0.25 so
actually the problem of GLOBUS is usually in females And the female,
commonest. Yeah.
Insomnia is not in females. The problem with that females is that they used to go to sleep at 10 or 11, and they have to get up at 5 for their children. So
you give tryptamine as well as haloperidol, both,
yes, sir.
And then Rivotril also. The patient is going to be drowsy whole day. Yeah?
Sir, I'm using 0.25 milligram. Amitriptyline, I never use more than 10 milligram. Mostly 5 milligram, half tablet.
Okay.
5 milligram of amitriptyline and 0.5 milligram Serenus works in 80% of patients. They never complain. Okay. For the initial few days, I usually add gabapentin 100 milligram BD because it has immediate effect on all these symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
But this haloperidol and amitriptyline combination works wonderfully in more than 80% of patient in within 10 to 12 days they have very good effect
so I think there are few questions which are being thrown at us and I think they all get answered somebody asked for dose of clonazepam and haloperidol and all that that's okay it has been answered by you very well I have few more questions
yes,
how will you manage vasovagal happening during feeds
sir I have not encountered anything
I have not told my seniors
to encounter it ideally you may spray but if you spray then the sensation of the larynx and pharynx decreases then the proper assessment won't there so spray is contraindicated and I have not come across any vasovagal attack
Yeah, oh, Dr. Sima, again the same question he heard that I also asked you. Serenase, amitriptyline, haloperidol, and tryptamine all together may knock out the patient for 24 hours.
No, sir.
Is it 5 happening?
Gram of amitriptyline and 0.25 milligram or 0.5 milligram. Haloperidol is not too much of sedative.
Mm-hmm.
Even it doesn't causes any problem gynecomastia.
Do you refer your patients to psychiatrist?
No, sir.
You don't. You manage all this on your own.
On my own. If patient is very much irritating me, then only. But patient won't go to psychiatrist for this problem. These are walking patients. They have only a lump sensation. Nothing else. So I am using less than what the company makes. 5 milligram of amitriptyline.
All these three things, cocktail of haloperidol, tryptamine and...
clonazepam, if patient is not having benefit with amitriptyline and haloperidol.
Okay. If not having benefit, then add clonazepam all together at night?
All together at night. 0.25 milligram of clonazepam. When the patient is having so much of problem, then he gets insomnia also. Otherwise, 5 milligram of amitriptyline and 0.5 milligram of Serenus hardly makes any problem. What we have to ask that he has to take at 7 p.m. I ask my patient to take at 7 p.m. so that when she
PM, okay.
gets up at 5 p.m., she has hardly any problem.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's a great idea, actually. I think this is a very, very good question and answer because this is a common problem and everybody is just wondering what to do. Hi, Dr. Basu. I received your message. Yeah. Any other question that anybody wants to ask? Let me check the whole list. Do you perform esophagoscopy routinely yourself? Yes,
sir. I have multiple endoscopes. I do everything on myself. I name them esophageal screening. Sometimes I have to do for dysphagia patient. Sometimes in the GLOBUS patient, if he has 2-3 times, he has came. Then I do, I'm not a gastroenterologist. I don't do UGI endoscopy, say. I do that esophageal screening. I have.
So you go up to the cricopharynx or just beyond it, or you go right up to the...
Sir, this FEES study by me is done by nasopharyngoscope.
Okay, so that doesn't go that far actually.
But no? Many a times I do transnasal esophagoscope. I have that in my OPD. When patient is having some more problem, I suspect that there may be some esophagus problem is there. Then I do transnasal esophagoscope. Otherwise, okay. Only fiber optic laryngoscope.
So then that means that you make the barium swallow redundant. Do you?
Sir, barium swallow is still needed in diffuse esophageal spasm. That is a separate topic. I have many patients with diffuse esophageal spasm. Typically, patient says that he has, or even the children has, sudden dysphagia lasting for few hours. Then for weeks, he is all right. Again, he has sudden dysphagia. He is not able to eat or drink anything for few hours. Specifically, the cardiac patients are there. In many times in cardiac hospitals or whatever post MI patient, when the patient is recovering or patient is walking, he says that for the 7-8 hours, he has absolute dysphagia. Then this attack may occur after 15 days or something. They are told that all those things. But when you get barium swallow done during the attack of dysphagia, then typically this cork is through and the spasm like things. I have many pictures. I don't know whether I can share or not. Can I share?
So, how long do you give medication for Globus? One more question. We can pass this on to Prahlad. Prahlad, can you do something which he's asking for?
Please, pardon?
He wants to upload some pictures or show some pictures which answers many questions.
Because we have another event of the 7:30 international event. And vestibular implants. Yeah, you can do quickly or we can give another session. Okay?
Yeah, okay, in future. Okay,
if you want, I can take a diffuse esophageal spasm. These are undiagnosed patients. I have, say, 10 or 12 patients I have diagnosed.
You're in the same presentation? It's in the same presentation?
It's in my computer.
Okay, I think we will do another session for that. Okay?
Yeah.
You can do so another part two.
Yeah, what is the time plan for now? Tell me, should we finish it or what is to be done? Tell me.
It's okay. I think if you have finished most of the questions, then we can.
The questions are being asked again. Many questions are coming, but I don't know the timeline. Tell me the timeline. What's the timeline?
Yeah, we can another 5 minutes. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So
practically the Globus problem lasts for months or years. The patient gets irritated and he stops taking when he sees that Globus problem is not problematic to him. And he manages himself, then he stops coming. After a few months, when again some stress comes or some acidity episode again increases, then the Globus increases.
So how long you continue medication?
Sir, first visit at least after 1.5 months. Then
1.5 months.
Then many a times I decreases the doses from 0.5 milligram of haloperidol 0.25. From the amitriptyline 10 milligram to 5 milligram, then sometimes it stops. But this haloperidol is wonder drug because it decreases the sensation of Globus in the patient. Many times if the patient is very intolerant to amitriptyline, even haloperidol and antacid drugs does the work wonderfully.
Okay. And patient with low... And this page, okay, we can leave that in the middle nasal segment. Esophageal reflux, do you manage patient with esophageal dysmotility in the mid and lower segment?
Yes.
And intra esophageal reflux, how do you manage? Do you have any answer?
Yes, sir. When the motility is there, dysmotility or diffuse esophageal spasm is there. I have searched the literature. Nobody has the perfect answer. But what I have known that muscle relaxant, both the smooth muscle relaxant and the skeletal muscle relaxant, we can use the baclofen. You can use the baclofen and chlorzoxazone for 1 month, and this during the episode of this diffuse spasm, I ask the patient to take monosorbitate dinitrate, this sorbitrate tablet. which is used in angina also. It decreases the incidence of diffuse esophageal spasm attacks. Many patients, the patient have stopped coming me. They are saying that wo dawai lete hain, toh then he becomes better. And lyophane and chlorzoxazone or baclofen and chlorzoxazone, I continue for 2 months or something.
Okay, great. Can you show scopy images of various GERD grades? I think this question can be skipped because it's a gastroenterologist domain, so let's not discuss that. Anything else? Pralad, do you have to any? You have any answer, question?
Yeah. Okay. I'm happy with the discussion. I don't have any personal question. Even I had the same problem, you know, this particular issue, globus hystericus.
Yeah, globus is the best question and best answer actually for everybody.
I personally learned something new today.
same here, because I refer patients to psychiatrists, but I think I can retain that money now with me.
You can call me. After 2 weeks, you start haloperidol. It is absolutely safe. In that dose, because psychiatrists used
to. I have myself noted down this cocktail, and I am going to start it from tomorrow itself. Let's see, and I'll call you and congratulate you for helping me out.
Yeah. So whatever, Rishi, those pictures, videos, and all you make, you can make another presentation. Okay.
Yeah.
Maybe after 2-3-4 weeks, we will have it again as part two. Okay.
Yeah.
Do that. I mean, doing good job. This thing. Yeah.
So we finish this, Pralad?
Yeah, I think we can finish it. I will let me wrap it up. Okay. Thank you very much, both of you, Dr. Raman. Busy schedule.
Thanks a lot for
sharing some time for saving your time here. If you permit, you know, we would like to have as a part of a Doctor's Day celebration, this thing, you know, one music program for you from you.
That would be wonderful.
Actually we had one earlier, somehow
you
know, couldn't get connected with you.
Great.
We had a last time we had a fantastic program, very good audience. We'll have it do it once.
Great. Okay, so thank you very much. I would love to do that. Thank you.
Yes
And thanks a lot.
We will have a part two.
Thank you.
Yeah,
I'm ready.
Definitely, we'll have a part two of this session. We'll extension of this, okay?
Sure.
Thank you very much. You're doing great job. Keep it up. Yeah.
Bye. Thanks.
Bye. Bye all. Thank you.